paper published in the volume. I got only two feedbacks.
Dear colleagues, I am Ivar Reimus from Estonian History Museum, as many of you know already, from Tallinn, and I would present you a medieval sample of a monetary union, which I call, and which actually is called a monetary union, which I believe to have existed since the mid 13th century until breakout of the Livonian War, and even a little bit further. So, what is a medieval Livonia first? So, it was a union or a confederation of minor feudal states. The Danish Duchy of Estonia, which existed until 1346, then it was taken over by the Teutonic Order, or its Livonian branch actually. Some of the territories of order, the blue one, then the bishopric of Tartu, or Dorpat in Germany, of Saaremaa or Özel, then the archbishopric of Riga, and bishopric of Kurland. So, the first one who issued the first known minting privilege in Livonia was Bishop Albert of Riga. he granted the Brehenseatic merchants, which were also called Universitas Mercatorum or Die Gotländische Genossenschaft, visiting Riga, the right to strike coins according to the standard of Visby, the main trade center in the Baltic then, the station on the way to the Russian markets. So here we can see the Gotlanding coin of that period. That is a coin of record minted by Bishop Albert, and by the next Bishop Nicolaus. according to the privilege of Albert, 4.5 mark pennies, in Latin marca denariorum, from a weight mark of silver, which was called marca argenti, and which precise standard is being disputed, but probably was around 210 grams. I personally think it could be a bit higher, about 120, but that's not so important at the moment. Had to be minted. Naturally, the Gotlandic counting system was implemented based on mark, which was equal to 8 öre, 24 örtuks, and 288 pennies, and the last one being the only real coins struck. In 1225, the legate of the Pope, William of Modena, solves a controversy between the bishop and the town, leaving the mint right for the bishop's prerogative, and once again setting the monetary standard in accordance to that of Gotland, but not specifying it more precisely. The coins of Albert as well as Nicolaus followed the same standard as the average weight of their coins reaches between 0.14, 0.15 grams, which means that, first, either the minters did not abide the decree of Albert, because according to his decree, the coins should be a bit heavier, or that the initial monetary standard from the very beginning was replaced by a new one, 5 mark coins from a silver mark. And characteristically, the same change happened in Visby, or on Gotland, where the minting standard of the late 12th century, which was 4 mark coins from a silver mark then, has been replaced by a new and more profitable one, first 5, then in 6 mark coins from a silver mark. The changes in the monetary standard of Gotland seem to have been accompanied by new coin types that are believed to have introduced about around 2010 and 20 respectively. Well, but it's not so important anymore. The first Stalin coins was struck around 1220 by the Danish king Valdemar, as well by the Archbishop of Lund and Vice Regent in Tallinn, Andreas Sunesen. That's Valdemar's coin and that's Andreas' coin. There is no documental evidence about the minting standard of these coins. However, the examination of a hoard of more than 100 coins from Kosovo and Tallinn suggests that they were minted according to the Danish standard, which where mark consisted of 240 pennies. It reveals that four mark pennies of average weight of 0.22 gram from a silver mark of approximately 210 grams were manufactured in Tallinn. Later on, since the mid-13th century, the Visby standard was adopted in Tallinn as well as a weight of coins rubies. And according to the decree of Queen Margaret from 1265, it should have been minted 6¼ mark Tallinn pennies from a white mark of pure silver. That makes 6 mark coins from an ordinary mark, silver mark of a purity of 15 lot. The poor silver was 16. In data calculations, 6 mark coins equal to a silver mark. Also, by the mid-13th century, minting of pennies of the similar weight was launched in Tartu. Here are the penny of Tallinn, here of Tartu. And some decades later, after 1279, the Bishop of Saaremaa joined the military standard and reckoned 6 mark pennies in a silver mark too. Here is a coin of that bishop. The same is to be said about the short monetary activities of the Teutonic Order in Livonia that minted around 1300, most likely in Riga. Yes, so one can claim that there was an actual monetary union between Gotland and Livonian powers almost from the very beginning. The reason for the unification of the coinages in the region was most probably the unity feeling of the pre-Hanseatic merchants acting in the Baltic region. They say Universitas Mercatorum. As well as the need for standardized currency. The only exception here was Courland, where the coinage started after 1252 according to the Prussian standard. But that's understandable because they started it in Mever, which is Klaipeda, nowadays Lithuania, and was a part of Prussia. Actually, it was a disputable territory between Prussian and Livonian branch of Teutonic Order. Well, almost during the whole 13th century, pennies minted in Visby were accepted in Livonia. Here we can see a hoard found some years ago in the sea in the Tallinn Bay. With a chunk of medieval pre-Hanseatic merchant was found on coins and scales and balances and weights and so on from about 1280. So, and here you cannot see, but you must trust me, there are coins from Tartu, mostly from Tallinn and from Visby. So, however, free circulation of the foreign currency in Livonian centres came to the end by the late 13th century. It may have caused by the further debasement of the Visby coins. Because a new coin type was introduced in Visby with a W, and these W coins were not found in Livonia or Estonia anymore, which means that they could not ensure the circulation here and had to be exchanged to the domestic money. But it also might have been a general phenomenon, as some restrictions concerning the circulation of coins even from the other local centers think rehabilit implemented in Livonia at the same time. In spite of that, the unified monetary standard was kept in Tallinn and Tartu, the two mints that more or less continuously struck coins, until the mints, for several reasons, were closed in the early 1330s. Instead, the coins from abroad now, the pennies of the North German towns and the Ertugs of Visby, came to circulate in Livonia. That's the first two-sided coins of that area, the Ertug of Visby, and here's some brackets from Lübeck, that's from Hamburg. A mixed and very complex counting system emerged. One mark, coins was equal to 6 shillings, 8 öre, 24 ertugs, 288 pennies. Consequently, as we learned before, a silver mark contained 6 times more, a silver mark contained six mark coins, so it contained 6 times more of every denomination, also 36 shillings, and you can read it here. So, but in 1361, the Danish king, Valdemar IV, captured Visby and laid heavy levies onto citizens. The significance of Visby was in decline, and suffering from the shortage of currency, the master border in Tallinn and the bishop of Tartu relaunched their own meeting in 1363 and 1465 correspondingly. Apart from the smaller denominations, there was one common monetary unit struck in both cities, the Ertug, which in Livonia was called Artic. Also, no special agreements were made, and the order even tried to obstruct meeting in Tartu. The coins from the both centers, as well as from Visby, circulated freely, side by side, as it can be demonstrated by the hordes. As the coins of Visby disappeared from the Livonian coin circulation, only in the 1390s, most probably due to the increasing volume of the domestic coin production. As to the North German pennies, their silver content was constantly diminishing, and the Livonians prohibited the influx of the debased bracteates in the 1370s already, and just in a very few cases they constituted a noteworthy part in Estonian hordes after that. As to the Livonian coins, analysis reveal that the Tartu artics were, as a rule, lighter and occasionally also of poorer silver than those from Tallinn. This difference was not significant, and most probably it was not detected in the beginning at all. But in the 1390s, as the Bishop of Tartu remarkably reduced the weight of his coins, it was responded by the Master of Order, who gave the ordinance to his commander in Tallinn to do the same. Thus, at least the master, despite what ill plans he could have, actually was maintaining the unified coinage in Livonia. It means that a monetary union, based on the geographical and economical integrity of Livonia, existed here de facto. It became even stronger after a new and smaller denomination, common denomination, Lübisch, one-third of Arctic, that initially was adjusted after the Lübeck pennies, was introduced both in Tallinn and then in Tartu at the same time. On the other hand, the debasement of coins brought along a change in the counting system. The value of the old silver mark now became that of the new counting mark, which was consisted now of 36 shillings, 49 öre, 144 artics, and 432 lübisches. No decimal system. So, a deep bullion famine was felt at the beginning of the 15th century all over the continent, including the lands around the Baltic. It resulted in rise of the price of silver and caused the debasement of the Artics in Tartu as well as the Lübisches in both meeting centers. The master of the order tried to stop meeting that bad money not only in Tallinn but also in Tartu, threatening the bishop to prohibit the use of these coins on the territory of the order. Seemingly, some agreement was achieved in 1416. But the bishop violated it very soon. The master was forced to give up his demands and continued minting according to the debased Tartu standard. Just during a couple of decades, the arti was debased approximately for 60%, the ruby share even more. The bad money brought along the corresponding downfall of the income of the landlords and the state owners. In order to re-establish the previous level of their revenues, negotiations on the coinage issues began between the master of the order, the Archbishop of Riga, and the Bishop of Tartu in 1420. The decision was taken to stop minting for 2 years all over the country and to prepare currency reform. However, the master did not trust the bishop and gave the town council of Tully an order to keep an eye on the minting activities in Tartu. Finally, on the initiative of the master of the order and the Archbishop of Riga, Diet, dedicated to the currency, was arranged in 1422. The Bishop of Tartu did not participate personally. He only by his representatives had signed the decree, which was aimed to restore good coinage and activities in Livonia. A new and improved monetary standard, the same and mandatory for all the emittents, was agreed and made public. However, every landlord has to coin under his particular coat of arms. I said it's now in middle Niederdeutsch. Ein Isig here der Munter soll unter seiner Herzog Wappen munter. An annual examination of the quality of coins was stipulated. Albeit all the landlords and clergy of Livonia were represented either personally or by their deputies, only three of them, the Archbishop, the Master of the Order, and the Bishop of Tartu, are recalled by their names in the end of the decree. These three authorities also complemented another decree on coinage a couple of months later. Thus, there's no wonder that since 1422, minting, which was stopped in Riga in the meantime, was re-established not only in Tallinn and Tartu, but also in Riga. From that point on, we may speak about the official monetary union in Livonia, constituted by the master of the order, the Archbishop of Riga, and the Bishop of Tartu. The Bishop of Saaremaa, who also possessed the mint right, did not use it any longer. Despite all the higher estates of real, including nobility, clergy, and the towns, normally discuss the monetary issues, the important decisions were made in the name of landlords, as they exclusively possessed the mint right. On the other hand, Livonian towns, in particular the three Hanseatic centers, Riga, Tallinn, and Tartu, had gained wealth and power and tried to defend the special interests that not always coincident with the policies of the landlords. This came obvious already in the very beginning of the monetary union. The aim of the landlord's decree I was talking about of 1422 was to restore the old quality of coins or even improve it, increasing the value of the new arts to fourfold. A later decree of 1424 stipulated that the peasants had to pay their obligations in new money that inevitably brought along the corresponding and sudden rise of prices on the local agricultural products and consequently would have made their export impossible. The monetary policy of towns, representing the interests of merchants, was aimed to maintain cheap money. And instead calling the new coins artics, they started to call them shillings, which were equal to four artics. This way, the counting mark did not contain 144 new coins, artics, as planned by landlords, but only 36. And the improvement of money turned to be another debasement, in fact. Still, however the new coins were called or counted, the monetary standard was kept by all the emitters. Ah, yes.
Yeah.
Indeed, occasionally the circumstances, in particular the increasing price of silver, disturbed this unity. By the mid-15th century, meat and shilling was stopped in all greens. It was restored after a long break only in 1490, but on a lower standard. Despite that, the price of silver continued to increase and seems to have caused unauthorized debasements in the mints by the end of the 15th, beginning of the 16th century. On the meeting of towns in 1504, the burgomaster of Tartu claimed that the common coinage was minted unequally. Gemelle pagamente ungelig werte mundet. That is, the minting standard was followed differentially in Livonia. Also, the decision was taken to return to the old coinage. That did not happen, and soon it was a master of order who complained that the towns for disobedience in minting issues. But in fact, the rise of the silver price stopped the minting activities in Livonia for a decade. Only in 1515, an agreement achieved between the towns and landlords. The master of the order and the Archbishop of Riga, there was no sign of Bishop of Tartu because there was sede vacante at that time, issued an ordinance that re-established minting and introduced a new and again lowest minting standard. And thus a more realistic policy of the towns won this time too. But even this standard did not last for long. The death of silver caused the towns to apply to the landlords for another debasement in 1527. But for this time it was categorically rejected by the master of the order. Despite that, the towns independently launched the production of shillings in Tallinn and pennies in Tartu of a lower standard in 1531. In Riga, tried to adapt that, what was disciplined by the master of the order. Still, the negotiations began again, and just in a year, the debasement, although kept in secret from the public, was approved by the landlords. The next attempt to debase coins was made by the joint proposal of the Livonian mint masters in 1547. Interestingly, that time the master of the order and the archbishop Bishop of Riga started to issue new coins even before the general agreement was achieved. But for some reason, this time that attempt was recalled, and minting has to be continued according to the previous standard of 1531. But soon enough, in 1551, the Bishop of Tartu demonstrated some private initiative, starting a counter-stamp old verdings, which were the quatermark coins, in order to give them a higher exchange rate of, they had to be of 9 shillings, but now they had to be the worth of 14 shillings. Next spring, the mint master of Tallinn followed his example. Since it has happened without common consensus, the master of the order intervened and ordered to stop the illegal stamping. However, it was allowed again next year, simultaneously. First in Tallinn, then in Riga, the ordinary coinage was launched and approved by the master of the order according to the proposal of 1547. The corresponding decision was officially taken by the Master of the Order, the Archbishop, and the Bishop of Tartu on the Diet in January 1554. The idea of the monetary union even exceeded the borders of Livonia. A certain unity with the Swedish coinage was not forgotten. As late as in the 1520s, the mint master in Riga noted that von Aldens die hier gemuntete Schilling mit den schwedischen Euro-Eingetrag. He was right, because the Italian shillings and the Swedish fyrks of the same period contained the same amount of silver. Correspondingly, the Swedish currency, Swedish mark, half mark, and 2 euro coins in Italian were evaluated according to the Swedish monetary system. In order to prevent the outflux of Swedish money to Tallinn, the Swedish king Gustav I the Vasa was the first Vasa in 1538 and 1540 applied to the town council of Tallinn and the master of order for the unification of the monetary standards in both in Sweden and Livonia. Since the exchange rate of Swedish coins was favorable for the citizens of Tallinn that time, this proposal was rejected. However, after debasement of Swedish coins, the situation on the money market changed radically. And now it was a Tallinn mint master, Urban Dehne, who suggested the transition to the Swedish money, Swedish monetary standard. But for some reason, his plans also remained unrealized. The things started to change in 1558, when the Russian-Livonian War broke out. In the same year, Tartu was conquered by Russians, the bishop was seized and taken to Moscow. In order to pay the mercenaries, the master of the order and the archbishop issued emergency coins with compulsory exchange rate. This one, as you see, one side coin, and then the guldens, they had to have an exchange rate two times higher as they intrinsic amount or value of silver or gold was. In addition, the master of the order tried to reduce the war expenditures by increasing the value and decreasing the silver content of the ordinary currency. That in turn was not approved by the archbishop, whose financial and military participation in the defense of the country was much more moderate. Thus, the master was forced to regulate the coinage by his own decrees. The negotiations with the archbishop started only in the autumn of 1560 and resulted in the joint decree on the both land rolls from the May 1561. It largely corresponded to the interests of the archbishop, almost re-established the pre-war quality of the coinage and the former exchange rate of thalers. The return of landlords to the better money is understandable. During all the previous centuries, they had preferred more valuable coins because these provided higher income from the nobility and the landlords themselves. All the debasements were carried out reluctantly and under the pressure of economic and sometimes political circumstances. This scenario seemed unrealistic for the Tallinn magistrate to achieve. The town did not agree on the stipulations of the landlords that time. It independently was looking for some savior from abroad. And meantime, stroke coins according to the master's previous and lower meeting standard until September 1561. Then, having sworn the oath to the Swedish king on 6 July already, the magistrate accepted the Swedish currency and its monetary standard, but did not abandon the old Livonian denominations. On November 28th, 1561, the Livonian Confederation was dissolved and new authorities started to rule here. Surprisingly, it did not mean the total collapse of the monetary union yet. Seemingly, the Archbishop of Riga, at least officially, followed the last agreed standard until his death in 1563. Only then the town Riga, which became a free city almost for two decades, debased its coinage. The decree of 1561 also was approved by the Danish Duke Magnus of Oldenburg, who became a new bishop of Saaremaa, and as such started to mint in 1562. The coin of Riga and the building of Magnus here. His mint master also began to diminish the silver content of coins. Thus, the war within a few years destroyed first the political and only then it terminated the monetary union that had persisted in one shape or another for three centuries. So, what we how can we summarize the things? During the period up to the 1561, a number of debasements were carried out in Livorno, but all they sooner or later got official approbation, and the minted parts in Livonia follow the agreed standard quite accurately. Certain malfeasances occurred, of course, but the problems were solved quickly and efficiently. Taking into account the very tense relationship between the Livonian landlords on one hand and between them and the towns on the other, one must wonder how they managed to keep the monetary union so long stable. The answer lies, seemingly, in similar economical and mercantile interests of the landlords and, in particular, the three most important Livonian towns. In addition, meetings, diets, etc. of the states of the land, of the lands, took place on a regular basis, giving chance to discuss the problems without longer delays. Thus, Livonia, although divided between a number of struggling powers, constituted a geographical and, in a sense, even political unity. The Livonian Confederation were also straight over interconnected, not only socially, but also economically. Here's the situation after that. You see a number of different coins from different powers. Here, Russian copies, that's actually a denser half a copy. Free city of Riga under the Polish power, shillings of Tallinn from the Swedish period, shilling of Polish power struck near Riga, Lithuanian half roads, shillings from Kura, and so on. So it's a total mess. So that's all. Thank you very much.